Welcome to the platform backend update for September 4th, 2017. My name is Dao Man and I am the platform backend lead at GitLab. And today I'm going to tell you, quickly walk you through what my team has worked on the last 5 weeks, what our plans are for the next 5. So to kick it off, in the last 5 weeks, one thing we did, which went unnoticed for most people, was that we soft launched translate.gitlab.com. This is the platform that's going to be used by our community members, as well as ourselves and any customers that might be interested in helping translate GitLab. We haven't announced this as a big thing yet because there's still some kinks we want to iron out. There's some things, some processes we want to document. There are some things we want to automate to make it a little bit easier for us to get these translations back into GitLab, for example. But this is something that Bob has been working on for the last couple of weeks, and something that Crowdin, the party that actually runs the application behind translate.gitlab.com, has been working on as well. They've been very helpful with us. We've been working with them to remove some performance issues and basically to get this up and running smoothly for a project like GitLab. So if you check out the status and next step links, there will be a little bit more about what still has to happen before we are going to announce this as a big thing. But of course, the plan is to announce this on the blog at some point as the canonical place where everyone who wants to can help GitLab be translated into more and more languages. Of course, that's only part of it. We also, as GitLab, need to make sure that all new features we develop are externalized from the beginning, which means that people can start contributing strings. And we are continuing to slowly translate new pages, externalize new pages, and make them ready for translation. So again, thanks, Bob, for working on that over the last couple of weeks. Then on August 22nd, we released GitLab 9.5. A couple notable things. First of all, GPG commit verification. This is a really awesome feature that we have wanted for a while, and it was pretty much entirely contributed by Alexis Riegel from Siemens. It is my understanding that Siemens allowed him, or at least authorized him to work on this GitLab submission, this GitLab contribution for a while, because it's something that they were interested in. And he did a great job. He worked really well together with Dimitri Zaporozhets, being our CTO, as well as some of our UX and front-end people to get this done. So that was one of the headliner feature for 9.5. And it's always nice when a headline feature is community contributed instead of built by the company. We also introduced a flow for buying a trial license inside the Enterprise Edition, which means that for new customers, it's now much easier to try out Enterprise Edition. If they install it, they will be, the admin who signs in will have the option to buy a trial license right from inside EE. Previously, they would need to separately go find our customer app, buy a license there, or not buy in this case, but download it there and then upload it into GitLab manually. And then until then, GitLab would just be very unhelpful and refuse to do anything. Now it has been streamlined and it's a lot easier for customers to get started with EE this way. Thanks, Ruben, for working on this, as well as Oswaldo, who is not in the platform team, but he did help with this as well as some UX people, because of course, a lot of work needed to be done in the customer app as well as in EE to make this a great experience for our users. Then third, we have Mirror Repository over SSH. We have had the Mirror Repository feature in EE for a while, but before now, it really only worked well when you were using HTTPS to move data between the two Git repositories. You could already use SSH with some tricks, but it wasn't possible to provide a specific, to pretty much see a specific public key inside GitLab that you need to upload to your other instance to allow this to be a secure SSH connection. And now this is an option. Check out the link if you want to know more about exactly how this works. But this is going to simplify a lot of things for people who don't want to have to configure a username password configuration inside GitLab that will always be stored in GitLab in order to use repository mirroring. So that will be great. Of course, there's a lot more that we did in 9.5, both on the side of my team, which you can find if you click the more link. And of course, the entire company did a lot of stuff that is not included here, which you can find if you go to the GitLab 9.5 link, which will link straight to the blog post that will tell you about all of these new things. Then a couple of days ago on September 1st, we launched GitLab.com feature plans. We already had plans in GitLab.com for a while, but they basically just affected how many CI build minutes you had available to your group or to your users' projects. Now we extend this with feature plans, bronze, silver, and gold, where the plan you are on actually determines what features you have access to. This roughly maps to what is the case for Community Edition, Enterprise Edition, and Enterprise Edition Premium, and a future Enterprise Edition Ultimate. But for GitLab.com, this works in much the same way, with, of course, some caveats where, for example, public projects get everything for free, but all of that can be found inside the blog post behind that link. A lot of people worked on this for many, many different teams. It really was a cross-functional effort, but I would like to specifically thank Ruben, Tone, Nick, and Bob for my team, who did a lot of great work over the last couple months to get this out. Then we are going to the next 5 weeks. So first, like I briefly mentioned, we are going to further improve our i18n, i18n being internationalization tooling, as well as translate.gitlab.com. We're going to automate some more stuff. We're going to write great documentation to get people up and running quickly if they want to contribute a new language or if they want to contribute to an existing language. And then, of course, this will also be announced on the blog, etc. Next, we are going to finalize GitLab 10.0 on September 7th and release it on the 22nd with a number of notable features. A big one is the option to configure object storage for LFS objects. This means that the LFS files that people upload into the repositories will not necessarily be stored on the actual disk, but you can configure it to store them in object storage like S3 or comparable products instead, which means that you don't need to buy huge hard disks, but you can leverage the huge hard disks that Amazon already has, or the ones that you set up yourself for this instead. We are also going to automatically reject commits that have missing LFS objects. This requires iterating over every incoming Git object and checking if they reference an LFS object and then verifying that the LFS object actually exists. This will make it a lot harder to forget to push LFS objects, or for example, to check out a project without having LFS installed, and then making some changes to the project that are not applied correctly because you don't have LFS locally. And we're also going to add automatic pruning of unreferenced LFS objects. We currently already have a feature where when a couple of projects all point to the same LFS object, of course, the LFS object will only be actually stored on disk once. And then when all of these projects, for one reason or another, get deleted, then the object gets cleaned up as well. But there's currently no way to get rid of an LFS object when the commit it was in or the branch it was in gets removed or the commit gets overridden using a force push. In this case, the LFS object will linger around, even though there are not actually any blobs inside the repository anymore that reference that LFS object. This is also something that we are working on for 10.0. There is a chance that it will slip because it's quite hard to get this to work in a performant fashion, but this is something that we have been working on as well. Next, we are doing a proof of concept GraphQL endpoint. We are not going to roll out a full GraphQL API for GitLab yet, but we're making our first start kind of trying out how GraphQL would work for GitLab. And we're starting with a specific endpoint that's around merge request data. And it basically provides all of the data that the merge request widget, the widget that has the merge button, the remove source button, the approve button, all of that stuff. All of the data it uses, it will now be able to get from the GraphQL endpoint. We are not going to actually replace the existing implementation of the merge request widget yet, or at least we're not going to get it to work with GraphQL just yet because there are some license problems, legal problems in the licenses that the JavaScript GraphQL library uses. But we are going to ship the backend of this, which will pretty much set GitLab up to start building more and more of these GraphQL endpoints and to start using them for GitLab components in the future instead of writing highly specialized APIs as we have been doing in the past. There are also going to be various performance improvements, including but not limited to those involving project creation, project export, commits, group member creation. If you check out those links or the various performance improvements link, you'll see a little bit more information on what we're doing there. Most of this has already been merged, so these are definite improvements going into GitLab 10.0. Of course, there's also various bug fixes related to, but not limited to, subgroups, mirroring, and passwords, specifically a password flow when an admin creates an account, but they are presented with a password form when they didn't expect to, that kind of stuff. I'm not implying that passwords don't currently work, because that would be a much bigger issue. And of course, there's a lot more that you can find in that more link that we are working on for 10.0. And then in 5 weeks, it will be really close to the release of 10.1. So that's when I'm going to be telling you about that. And in the meantime, I'm looking forward to working on 10.1 and making stuff to tell you about in 5 weeks. Have a great rest of your day, everyone.